So good afternoon. Today we have Andrea Stille talking about healthy custom Debian distributions. let me ask you to, when you're going to ask a question, please wait until the microphone reaches you and look at the camera and say your name. Thank you.
Thank you. Hello. I hope I'm not boring you with two talks on one day, and I hope to make it a little or quite different from what I said before. And apropos healthy, I do not know who just joined the wine and cheese party yesterday. I realized I was not able to wake up 2 hours, for 2 hours. Normally I wake up 2 hours earlier, and I want to know which wine was responsible for this. So I would like to do a test, make the amount of wine from Argentina, Brazil, whatever, in one slot, and the other wine in the other, and then test those wines. If it works, then we have finally, by splitting them up in different groups, and find out the wine which was responsible for sleeping so long. But so now for the real topic, I would like to say something about the history of Debian Med very shortly, and my concern is to show you what might be a good idea to build a CDD or just a custom Debian distribution which works in a specific field. And if you try to do this, we have had several tries, which was in most times a failure, which things you should do and which things you should avoid. And I think I found some way to measure which is really healthy and which is not a working CDD. So this is my part three of this talk. So what about the history of Debian Med? It was just at DebConf 1 in Bordeaux. It was also known as LibreSoftware meeting. This was kind of cool conference. It was the first two Debian conferences happened in Bordeaux. It was called DebConf 0 and DebConf 1. And it just happened that we had a formal dinner, as we can experience it tomorrow in this conference. And in this day happened the following. There was a medical track, which was a reason why I was sponsored to go to this conference. And there was a guy sitting in and was constantly busy translating installation advices for some medical program. I thought, well, this guy is busy translating installation advices, but should the installation advices be translated, or should we rather have an installer for this program? So, I mean, build a software package, say apt-get install, whatever. And so we had some wine, and then we started thinking about it, and so we stopped drinking wine and made a laptop open and start preparing a talk about how to do things right. Instead of just translate some texts nobody really wants to read, because who really wants to read install advices? You want to run a program and not are busy with installation. So in the process of this formal dinner with some wine, I prepared the first talk about the not yet existing project, which was called later on Debian Med. And that means we begin from zero. So this is an optimal situation. You cannot fail. If you are growing from zero, something is happening. This was quite easy. And the idea of the custom Debian distribution was actually born in the year 2000, which was rather called Debian internal projects. The idea was from Ben Armstrong, and he thought, well, my children are small. I want to make a system which they want to use, not just father, can you help me, but they should be happy about the system and keen on using it. And so the idea was we assemble a set of nice games for children and find a way to install them easily. And I adopted this idea for Debian Med, and Holger told us there was Debian Edu and Scala Linux growing up in parallel. The Debian Edu project somehow died and was not maintained anymore. And so my suggestion was to the Scala Linux people, take over Debian Medu. You now are Debian Medu, and it is became somehow one. And further in DebConf 3 in Oslo, there was a decision these Debian internal projects should somehow differentiate between other internal projects like installer or internal hardware support or so, to differentiate between technical projects and user-oriented projects. And this was the birth of the name Custom Debian Distribution. And I admit I'm absolutely not happy with this name because it's so confusing. I mentioned in the talk before, if you hear Custom Debian Distribution, you think, well, the name Custom, it is something else than Debian. Somebody takes Debian, do some stuff and releases it. And this is actually not what we want. We want to make a system as much integrated as possible in Debian to keep the maintenance efforts as low as possible. If you are deriving from Debian, you are constantly busy to change the installer, whatever. We want to have one handle to switch and to make the installation medium for the Custom Debian Distribution very similar to everything else, which is plain Debian. So we have other projects like Debian Accessibility. It is oriented to blind or visually impaired people, and these people do not actually call themselves Custom Debian Distribution, but in principle they are doing what we are doing as well. And I come back later to why I'm list this project here. Quite similar, it is Debian Desktop. It makes no sense to talk so much about Debian Desktop. On the one hand, it is not a real custom Debian distribution in the sense as Debian Accessibility, because I do not accept the techniques or whatever. And it is it's kind of silent, this project. There is not so much outcome. In Debian Lex, which was intended for lawyers, to make a system for lawyers, I think it is a really good project from the idea, but it was more or less run by one person, and this person left Debian somehow, and that is not so much outcome anymore, or more or less non-outcome. The Debian non-profit project tried to build a system for a non-profit organization. I think it's also a really good goal. You could do several stuff to maintain some agencies or maybe conference maintenance projects or something like this. Unfortunately, this more or less died, this project. Project list is even closed now. There is also Debian GIS. Debian GIS is a very interesting project. They try to assemble all these geographical information systems. They did not yet accept our tools, but they are currently busy to do so. So this can be called a custom Debian distribution in so far, because everything's also inside Debian. It is quite similar with DebiChem. It is for chemistry, also chemical packaging, chemical projects. And the problem of these both, Debian GIS and DebiChem, is they concentrate mostly on just getting projects packaged. So we are more or less a packaging team. In my opinion, building a custom Debian distribution is more than just building packages. It is about contacting the users and building a real framework to make something people really want to have. Not only that it's nice to have some ready to install software, but a distribution is more than assembling and collecting software and putting even more to the archive. We do want to do a little bit more. And finally, Debian Enterprise. It's a cool idea, but I would call this project a failure, and you will see why it did not work. I will elaborate more on this stuff. So I thought about how can I measure the health of the CDD. I have to do some statistics, some numbers. And well, we could think about the number of users of the CDD. So in free software, the problem, you don't sell anything, though you have no real numbers who uses your stuff. So what do we have? We have popularity contest. I guess everybody knows if you install Debian CD, you will be asked, are you happy with reporting which packages are installed and so. And this popularity contest is a nice thing to obtain the numbers of the whole archive, which packages are used most frequently. But here we have a problem. We have by definition special users, and the special users need some special software, and so the PopCon numbers will always be low for the important package. So the popularity contest number is not really a good measure for this, or to find any answers how good a CDD is working. Well, we could try to make this measure on the meta packages, which meta packages are used and which are not used. The problem with the meta packages is PopCon counts the number of installations, and it also verifies that the files inside the package is really used. So in first time, if you install Debian, you can install a lot of packages, but finally you use only 50 or 100. And so the number of installations of the meta package can be counted, but the meta package does not really contain files which are used. It is just used to get other packages included or via the dependencies. And so you have no real measure whether this meta package is really used or just installed. So we have no real handle to count the number of users. What about the number of developers? Well, you could look at the VCS commits, but not all the CDS really use common VCS, and so it's a little bit hard to make an equivalent measurement between the projects I'm talking about. And well, I thought the activity is some kind of reflected in the mailing list. No, the first numbers you are thinking the mailing list subscribers. So, but this doesn't work also because, well, we have different projects. I have just got the mailing list numbers from for four of these projects, and you see somehow in the beginning of the project the number of subscribers grows, and then you gets to kind of plateau. And the problem is, independently whether the mailing list has some postings or not, the subscribers seem to remain somehow. It is if there are no postings, they even know that they are subscribed to this list, or it is in the spam folder or whatever. So it is hard to say, well, we regard the number of subscribers, it does not scale, this number doesn't work. And it is a little bit better with the number of postings. You see Debian Meet, the number of postings is continuously increasing. Here you have the effect with Debian Edu. There was not much in Debian Edu until 2003, and then Scholar Linux joined, and this makes a huge amount of much more mails, and now this project is really good working. So there is a different effect in Debian Junior. This was the first CDD, and you see that the number of postings tends to decrease. You have some peaks, and I will talk about these peaks, which are somehow, well, it is hard to say something about this graph because there's much noise in it. These graphs also reflect some several spam mails and whatever, or automatically generated mails. So this also doesn't really help. And if you look at this Debian Lex, this peak, I know this. This was a tweet about should we revitalize this list. So this makes one peak and doesn't happen. But you can't obtain this facts I know from this graph. So the numbers you had at first in mind from the mailing list, so number of subscribers and numbers of postings, do not really work to obtain a measure what's really up with this project. Because you have signal and noise and several artifacts. And it is not so that only spam is a noise. I would also regard, as I said, commit mails of VCS, which are sometimes posted to the list. It's also not really relevant to obtain whether this CDD is really working as a community, as some project, or just as a packaging group. You have also some mails with, I want to unsubscribe, unsubscription did not work, please could you subscribe me, and something like this. So I mentioned this peak of the Debian Junior list in October 2003. It was only one thread. The thread, it was about should we replace RBWord by Lux with OpenOffice, and then there was philosophy of the text processing program or future replacement, whatever. So he had 79 postings about a very specific topic out of 89 non-spam messages. So this was kind of a flashing light in this list, but the tendency is unfortunately quite decreasing. Then you have this kind of robots, for instance, there was, in December 2009, 92 messages to debiandesktop.org, which was kind of subscription, unsubscription to some funny Gentoo list. I don't understand the sense, and it's nothing against Gentoo, but I just was looking at the mailing archive, and I thought, whoa, what's this? So many mails, but it was nothing. And this automatically mails, so this are just artifacts which are somehow, it just does not work how to measure the health of a CDD. So a different measure would be, we have these meta packages, and what is the number of dependencies? If the dependencies are growing, people are working on this, and it seems to grow healthy. This is most probably a quite good measure, and the problem is it is hard to obtain, because up to I think the beginning of this year, only two of these CDDs were using this technique with the meta packages, and so you have no measure for the others, because they just did not use this meta package technique, and they also did not necessarily use the VCS, where you can easily obtain the history of these meta packages. And I did some querying of snapshot.debian.net, and because I even didn't had the numbers for the project I'm running myself, this Debian Med, but I was able to obtain some statistics I was quite happy about, because this Debian Med is divided into biology, microbiology part. You must know, it sounds strange, Med, if I go to the doctor, what's about biology? But I'm working in a medical institute which cares for finding out which influence had which virus and whatever, and they have to do some genetic research, and there is some comparison of genetic code of bacteria, and so we have some very specific microbiology software, and there is a lot of this software. We have, we are scratching on the tip of the iceberg. If we want to have all of this software, we had numbers of 500 or so, but not every. It makes no sense to package everything. We try to package, the most popular one, which is used by many people. And so you see a large increase here, and even in the beginning of the Debian Med project, we had some 5 or 6 microbiology packages. This, the reason was simple. We had one Debian developer which was working in the on the French Pasteur Institute. It was Stefan Boltzmeier, or how it's pronounced. And he put it into Debian, some random microbiology package which he was using. And then he left Debian, and they were all found. And so I just took this over and tried to bring them in good shape and started with the first meta packages. And we also had something for medical imaging. So in the beginning there was, yeah, I said nothing. Those there were some packages, but not in a real structured shape. And you see a constant increase of the number of packages. That means the interest in the Debian Med project was constantly growing. And even since 2005, we have some practice management program. We have one practice management program out of 20 existing, but all these 20 are competing with different programming languages, with different databases they want to use, and are mostly done by one developer who has a strong opinion about his program and is not compatible with another developer who has another strong opinion. So the situation in the free software in medicine, especially in practice, is quite hard. It's a real problem to find a straight line there, and my intention is also to propagate the project I think which are serious and which are developing quite straightforward, and that's why I try to package exactly this to make them a little bit more popular. And I hope that this will also increase here over time. This is only a selection. We have some more meta packages, but these one are the most interesting one for this graph to make it not crowded. So, as I said, in principle, the number of dependencies in a meta package could be useful, but we do not really have this number. So what about the activity of members? As I told you, the number of subscribers and the number of postings are not very interesting, and here is a very drastic example of the Debian Enterprise project. You see, you have in 1 month six postings maximum, but 140 subscribers. So, well, this is a really strange one, but when I've seen it, I wanted to know who is actually posting to this list. There are really persons, and so, and I got the idea that, well, I call it communication measure, whatever, activation measure. I wanted to know who is actually the most active post on the list. Is it changing over time? Is it always the same? Or, well, every CDD has a mailing list, and we wanted to get rid out of these robots. And if I look at the people who are actually posting, I get rid of the spam, because spam is sent by not the same person, and so it gets out. And all the flame bars and so, the effect is reduced, because you are looking at specific persons. So I tried to fetch the top 10 posters of every mailing list. That means I was browsing the index of the mailing lists over the years, counted which poster is the most frequent poster, and the other 10 were displayed over the years, you will see. And I would like to remind you, especially the so-called run over by bus factor. What do I mean with the run over by bus factor? This is the example of Debian Med to explain the graph. Here, Andreas Tille, it's me. Okay, I was starting the project, and starting a project makes some noise. Well, this is a normal thing. there are many postings. And if we forget the first year, the amount of postings of my posting is increasing, except of 2006, where I had some private stuff to do and was not that active. It is quite interesting that this is reflected here. And until 2005, if I would have stopped posting, the list would have been died. I'm really sure, because there is nobody else who is that active. But the really interesting thing, in 2006, there came a second one. This is Charles Plessy. This was actually the year where I was decreasing with my activity. And he would then became a second very active member who is completely able to take over what I'm doing. And I'm really, really happy. He cares for so many interesting things, organizing stuff and making release stuff and all the things. So this is what I would call a healthy CDD. If they run over by bus factor, if I would be catched by a bus and could not work anymore for DebianMate, this project will not die because somebody else is there and will take over. If you look at the third, this is David Palaino. He is a very active person who does some stuff, who joins the project in 2007. And he does not so much about coordination, but he has done great work, has written all this web stuff I mentioned in my talk this morning. And so we have three very active developers. The fourth is Carsten Hilbert. He is actually a user. This is also interesting that the user was also from the beginning here, and this user is in this aspect, it is the developer of this practice management project, and he is an upstream developer, but he uses Debian, and in so far he is a user, and acts in the sense to, well, I would like to get my program packaged by you, and I hope you can help me and has some inspiring ideas how we can make our project better. And the other ones, Nelson de Oliveira is a Brazilian guy. I would have hoped he is here in Mar del Plata, but he didn't. He's also a Debian developer, and Steffen Möller, and we have also some competence in this project. Well, I myself, I'm a physicist, so in principle, I'm not really competent for medical stuff. But Charles Plessy is a biologist, David Palaino is studying odontology, Carsten Hilbert is this doctor who programs GNU-Med, Nelson de Oliveira is like Charles Plessy, and also Steffen Müller, very good in microbiology. Then we have Michael Hanke, he is a developer of medical imaging software, so we have some competence, and you have seen on the graphs that medical imaging is growing. So if you see the people who are working on this, you see that the development is quite interesting. And what I also want you to mind is that we do not lose people. At first, this was quite sparse, but in the end, people keep on with their activity. And this is something I would like to remind you, because in other projects, people were active and then dropped their activity. And this does not happen, so I would call this healthy. What about Debian Edu? I told you in the first 2 years, that did not happen so much, because this Debian Edu project, this Debian Edu project needed some, well, external blood or whatever. And in 2003 was at the conference in Oslo, and then the Scholar Linux people joined this project, and it starts to become what I would call healthy. They have the main activity is by Peter Reynoldsen. He is a technical person, a Debian developer, and he makes strategic decisions and so on. And the second active poster, this is also interesting, is a teacher and, well, more or less a user. But this this high user interest is also a very important thing. And this is very good that this person is constantly posting. Holger Lefsen should be known to you from the talk before. You see exactly when he joined the project with his activity. It started in 2005 a little bit, and then he became very active. And so you have two main developers there, and so the run over by bus factor is also greater than one. Here you can see also Jonas Smedegaard is also quite active, and Knut Irwin is the guy who is a very good politician. He is convincing the Norwegian government that Scholar Linux is exactly what they want to have, and so he is really great. So the type of main active people is different, and they connect very well together. So this is also a very good situation. If you see my own name there, it is not because I'm so deeply involved in the project, but I try to find interconnection stuff with the healthy CDDs, and so I'm looking on this list and are posting the general things which are interesting. So I would not really call myself as a strong member in this team, but the six people before me are a really strong team. So what about Debian Junior? I told you that the initial idea was from Ben Armstrong. But you see also if you start a CDD, you have a lot of postings. I have this idea. What do you think about it? Should I do this and that? And I was quite happy with this project and was responding to this idea from the beginning. And the project was quite active until 2002. And then you see a decrease in the postings of the main poster. And this decrease, with the exception of 2006, where he wanted to, well, please guys, let's revitalize this project, it did not really help so much. And you also see the project was losing people. Here there were some active people, they are not in the end. So this project is obviously dying. And this is a shame, because I think it's a really nice project and it should survive somehow. And the last mails over there, where Ben Armstrong is a really clever guy, and he is a good strategic guy, and he said, well, my interest just drifted away. My children grow up, and so my interest is now in the EEE PC. Could somebody take over this job? And he said, this job contains several points. And he also has written a nice documentation. What you have to do if you want to start such a project, what you should be aware about. It is I included this in the documentation for the CDDs. This is Ben Armstrong's part, and he tries to make an effort that somebody else takes over this role of the main active poster or whatever. I hope he is successful. And I think if I'm ready here with all these preparations, I try to help him with kickstarting in a new life. So the next thing is Debian accessibility. Well, this project by definition has some problem. You have not so many users for this. There are not so many users which are blind and or visually impaired, and so well there are such users, but it is a quite kind of special software, and they have to work very hard to get some users or get some attraction. And I know that Mario Lang is a Debian developer who is blind himself. And that's why he started this effort. I don't know the other ones, but you see, you have some posters which are on the top 10 list, which are doing very few postings. And so this is not so active. And I hope that we could give some inspiration to the project by letting them implement this CDD stuff, which gives perhaps some visibility to this project. It is, I would like to say, it is not visible, as the people can't see themselves or whatever. It is, It's a shame that it's not so vital, but it is just a problem of the number of users. Well, Debian Desktop was an effort to, well, the problem with the flexibility of Debian that we have not the most up-to-date software, and so they wanted to bring, they wanted to implement the system to bring unstable in its shape, that is releasable, and somehow the idea was not bad, but I think they were overrun by efforts like Ubuntu and so, and the interest was in the beginning not so high, then it got a peak by Gustavo Franco, but he obviously dropped, lost interest and stopped posting, and so, well, it's not what I would call healthy. Debian Lex, as I said, it could be a quite competing project for Debian Mate. You have about the same number of users. I think there might be the same number of doctors as lawyers, whatever, and they need some special care. So the idea is good, but even if you look at the starting point, it is not that high as in the other project. So there was not so much energy in it. And the blue peak is done by a user who calls himself LexList. Well, it is anonymous. I don't like it. If somebody has something to say, he can say it with its own name. And he found this name to revitalize this list, and that's why this peak and the other responses are from the other people. But in principle, you can close this list because there's nothing. It's a shame, but we just have to face this. So, and I just want to make you aware that this method I found to evaluate a list works in this example, because you have this peak scene, this blue peak, and this is about Debian Rebirth. So all this posting are about one topic, and well, it also makes no sense. If they are talking about do we want to implement something in Python, Perl, or PHP? This is a specific technical detail. It's nothing what helps our users. The user wants programs that work, and not programs in Python or programs in PHP. They want programs that work. And if a project is in a situation where they want to decide this technique is preferred and this not, then this is not our business. They should find good quality software and bring them in a real good system which is ready for our users and not this kind of discussion. So this is also a good example for the, I call it Vanished Leader project. Then we have this Debian non-profit custom Debian distributions. Also here we have a main poster. He got some other posters who sometimes posted quite frequently, but in principle this list is dying, and the last peak is only should we remove this mailing list, and it is just not existent anymore. So Debian Enterprise is this funny list where you can get on the list of top 10 posters if you have two postings. This is quite interesting, and this is even a spam mail. So, so we should definitely close this list because there's nothing. The idea is very good, and it's a shame that it's just the idea and nobody who cares, but this is a problem. Yes, we created this mailing list somehow in 2007. It exists only for 2 years. Yeah, I think it, formerly I thought it was somehow there was an effort of Ian Murdoch to make an enterprise Linux or something like this, but this was somehow former. So I do not really remember the sense, but the idea was, well, Debian has no certification for running Oracle or so, and it's an interesting thing to make Debian in that way enterprise ready, that we provide ready to run solutions. And I would have loved if this effort would somehow get something, but just nothing. So and then there is a general list. It is not a specific project, but it was my intent to bring all these custom Debian distributions together to find a common technique. And here you see, in principle, this is also not really healthy, what you see here. The reason, or my expectation, what might be the reason, is that all these projects somehow independently existed and never talked to each other. And I'm constantly busy with trying to make these people join together and try to use all this the same technique. And finally, I found the reason, because talking doesn't help. You have to provide some technique to use which is attractive enough to make people want to use this technique. And this is, I think, these task pages I have shown in the morning are somehow convincing to other people. And though there are other projects like this DBChem project, which care for chemistry programs, well, they just concentrated on adding more chemical packages to Debian. But at some point, they found out, well, that's not enough. And this is exactly the idea I had. And when the main, he would show up at main poster, I have no stats here, the main leader of the DBChem project, which is Michael Bank, have seen this task page and said, oh, that are you doing? This is cool. I want to do this all the time, but I found out for the time. So I think we have the next two or three CDDs which are trying to use the same technique. And I really hope that the stats of this list will grow again, because there are a lot of common things to discuss on this list. And so you see several people you have seen before. Well, you see me, Ottavio Salvador was very active in the Debian non-profit project, and Ben Armstrong, the Debian junior man, and Jonas Medegaard is in the Debian Edu project. And this is also a very interesting entry here, because Vagrant, exactly, this graph is wrong there. This is one person, and he would get even higher. I have to fix this. He is a man who has written a tool which is called SimpleCDD. And SimpleCDD, well, what is it? It is a nice tool in any case, but it creates something which is then lives outside Debian. It is an installer for something else than Debian, in principle. And so this is, in principle, a famous misinterpretation of the name custom Debian distribution, because it is not really what we want, but, well, he said, well, CDD, it's what I'm doing. And so this list is also even misused by people posting to this topic. So we have some mix up here, but we have finally nothing done against it, because discussing things about special purpose might not harm the list, but definitely we need some more straightforward topic here in the list. And it's a little bit, well, I'm not happy about this situation, but I'm hopeful that we can increase it. So what's the conclusion? Most CDDs depend from a single person. And it is good if you have at least two or three which are really active. Debian Edu is really healthy, because it has a strong crew. And also Debian Med has kind of good run over by bus factor for, well, two or three persons. And this is definitely very important to have a successful project. And those projects who has only a single person are somehow dying at some point, because you can't rely that a free software developer will always work for this topic. There are so many attractive topics around you can catch, and so, well, you become distracted, and the former project is in danger to die. And we need much better management in between the CDDs. This is also the main conclusion I would like to draw. And at this point I'm in principle at the end, and you will find this talk soon at this location, and yeah, I would be happy if you have some remarks for better communication or whatever. So any questions? We had also not so many questions my first talk. I said, well, either I have explained everything so good that you have no question, or I have completely failed explaining what to do. So, well, there is no point in sticking here in the room. If there are no questions, you can reach me over the whole conference. I hope you enjoy the talk. And if you like to prepare some CDD, just keep in mind what I've told you.